I worship you, I worship you. You are here working in this place. I worship you, I worship you. You are here moving in a mist. I worship you, I worship you. You are here working in this place. I worship you, I worship you. Hey, waymaker, miracle walker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle walker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here touching every heart. I worship you, I worship you. You are here healing every heart. I worship you, I worship you. You are here turning lives around. I worship you, I worship you. You are here mending every heart. I worship you, I worship you. Hey, we make a miracle walker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. That is who you are. Hey, we make a miracle walker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. You wipe away all tears, you mend the broken heart. You're the answer to it all, Jesus. You wipe away all tears, you mend the broken heart. You're the answer to it.
Morning, new creation, and everyone who's tuning into our broadcast, thank you for joining us on this wonderful Resurrection Sunday. Thank you for taking the time out to watch this video. We just want to thank all our new creation family for continuing to give. Thank you for all that you're doing. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for all that you are committed to do for new creation. This morning, I want to continue our series on faith is greater than our fear. One of the things that we've been looking at in the book of Psalms is who God is. Well, this Sunday, I want to transition. And I want to transition us from the book of Psalms to the book of Hebrews. And our text for this morning will be Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 through 3. But before we get into that, let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for this day and thank you for allowing us to come and listen and hear your word. Thank you for your word. Thank you that you have given us everything we need in your word. Thank you for sending your son Jesus to die on the cross for our sins. Thank you that he rose on this Sunday. Thank you that he got up. And because he got up, we can now live for him. Thank you for all that you do. And now, Lord, as we look at the book of Hebrews, be with us. Continue to keep us. Continue to watch over us. As we dig into your word, let the words of my mouth, the meditations of my heart, be holy and acceptable unto you, my rock, my strength, and my redeemer. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. The book of Hebrews, starting in chapter 12, verses 1, says, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance this race marked out for us. Chapter 1 starts out with a very interesting word, therefore. And in order to understand why that's there, we've got to go back. And I'm not going to go and walk through the whole book of Hebrews, but I do believe that we need to look at chapter 10, 11, and 12. So in chapter 10, we see that the writer of Hebrews is calling for the Hebrew people to persevere in faith. In verse 35, it says, so do not throw away your confidence. It will be richly rewarded. Verse 36 says, you need to persevere so that when you have done the will of God, you receive what he has promised. The writer stops there and says, we're part of a greater family. And then he gets into chapter 11, which many scholars or many people consider the hall of faith. It's faith in action. And what we see in chapter 11, we saw last week, it says, verse 1 says, now faith is the confidence in what we hope for and the assurance about what we do not see. And it says, and without faith, in verse 6, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. What we see in chapter 11 is a what they call a hall of faith. In Canton, Ohio, there's what they call the Pro Football Hall of Fame. And these are the best of the best, the creme de la creme, the best football players on the face of this earth. They have walked this game, put a stamp on the game, and made it so that everybody would know who they were. And that's what we see in chapter 11. We see the likes of Enoch. It says that he lived with God and God didn't allow him to die. He just called him up to heaven. We see Noah who built the ark. We see Abraham who left his country and went to a country God showed him. We see the likes of Isaac, Jacob, and Moses, just to name a few. And so the Hebrew writer is showing us all throughout the Hebrew history, all of these giants of the faith, these guys who laid out and put a mark on this world. And they wasn't received well. Some of them were ridiculed and scorned, and some of them were criticized. But what we see in verse 39, it says they were all commended for their faith, yet none of them received what had been promised, since God had planned something better for us, so that only together with us would they be made perfect. The Hebrew writer reminds us, he says, these guys were great, but they didn't receive what they were promised. Abraham was promised that he would be the father of many nations. He didn't get to see all those nations develop. He only had one son. But what we see is that Abraham was faithful to God and did exactly what God has said. And then we get to chapter 12, verse 1, and it says, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders us and the sin that easily entangles us. He says, we're surrounded by a cloud, and that image is we're able to look up and see all of these people who went before us, all of their ancestors, the Hebrew ancestors that went before them that showed a great level of faith. He says we're surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses. But, you know, those great cloud of witnesses is for the Hebrew people to look up to. They're not looking down on the people and seeing what they're doing. It's saying that we have examples to live by. He says, since we have this great cloud of witnesses, let's run our race. The Hebrew writer uses the act of running and running a race to equal the Christian life. And he says, let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. He says, but before we do that, we got to throw off everything that hinders us. Everything that gets in our way. And it says, and the sin that so easily entangles us. You know what I noticed? I noticed that when track runners run, they don't run with a whole lot of clothes on. Matter of fact, they usually get some of the smallest shorts you can find. And I want to thank my teenage student here at New Creation for allowing me to see these. I would put them on, but y'all don't want to see me in these. They put on some shorts, some small shorts and a tiny jersey. And this is what they run in. And the reason why they do that is so that they can be free and loose and nothing will get in their way. And that's what the Hebrew writer is saying to us. He says, let us throw off everything that hinders us. You know, not everything that hinders us is bad. If we combine what hinders us with the sin that so easily entangles us, that incorporates everything. That encapsulates everything that could hurt us or keep us from running our race. And so some of the things that hinder us is like things like money. We set out to get money, or we set out to have a job, and our job could be a hindrance for us living this Christian life. Or our family could hinder us from doing what God has called us to do. And that's a hindrance. Or it could be sin inside of us, the sin of greed, the sin of self-reliance, not the wanting to deny ourselves, but depend on ourselves to run this race. The Hebrew writer is saying, let us run and let us throw off everything that hinders us, that gets in our way. I liken it to this example. If I was to see my child fall into a pool while holding a sack of gold bricks, if I was to see them fall into the pool and not being able to swim, am I going to continue to hold on to that bag of gold bricks? No, I'm going to throw it away. I'm going to throw it to the side, and I'm going to run as fast as I can to get there to save my child. That's the same thing the Hebrew writer is urging the Hebrew people to look at and to see. It says, if we love Jesus so much and if we are in a relationship with him, let us throw off. Look at the term. It says throw off. It's not just put it to the side so that we can see it and go back to it, but throw it off. Throw it away. Get rid of it so that we can run this race. But he tells us to run the race with perseverance. Perseverance means endurance. See, New Creation, this race isn't just a sprint. It's a marathon. It's actually more like a steeplechase. You ever seen a steeplechase? It is the craziest race to me. They got hurdles. They got to jump over and jump on a hurdle and jump over a little lake of water. And then they gotta run around the track. It's kind of like that, because the Christian life isn't just a straight, easy path. It's got its obstacles in it. But each one of us have our own race to run. My race isn't going to be like your race. Where do you get that from? It says we got to run the race that's marked out for us. Everybody has a race to run. Listen, in high school, I was as slow as molasses. You didn't want me running a sprint. You didn't want me lining up and running a 100-meter dash. But I could run for a long time, so I probably would have been better at cross country or the long distance runs. I wasn't fast, but I had endurance. And that's what the Hebrew writer is urging these people and getting them to see, and he's relating it to a Greek race. He says, run this race that's marked out for us. God has clearly marked out the race that he wants us to run, and he's saying, run it with perseverance. Run it with endurance. Endure to the end. Don't stop. You know, I never seen a person win a race that stopped and went back to the finish line. I never seen a person win a race that as soon as they started, they stopped and they got down the road a little bit, and then they got hit with a obstacle or a setback, and then they said, you know what, I'm done running, I'm going to leave. And to be honest, we see that all the time in Christianity. We see these people who come to know Jesus Christ and get on fire for Christ. But then once an obstacle hits them in their path, they say, you know what, I didn't sign up for this. You know, you told me that if I was obedient and if I was faithful, that I'm going to get all this stuff and I'm going to live a healthy and wealthy life and I'm going to get all these things. And the Bible is saying run with endurance. And some of these doctrines and some of these theologies that are out there, the naming and claiming and do what you want to do and live the way you want to live, and then God is going to bless it as long as you're faithful. That stuff doesn't jive with what the Bible has, because the Bible says, let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. But he doesn't stop there. He says, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. Some of your versions may have the author and finisher of our faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. The Hebrew writer goes on, he says, you know, there's going to be a lot of people that have faith. We have a great cloud of witnesses, and all those people were demonstrations and examples of having great faith. Even in our own lives, we have people who have faith that we can look to. I think about my parents, who demonstrated faith when they left their home country of South Africa to move to this country. They demonstrated faith in that step to leave that country where all their family is and to come here and set up roots here in America. We have, each one of us have those people in our lives that we can look to. Might have been a former pastor of yours, or it might be a friend that just demonstrates great faith, a grandma, a big mama, a somebody in your lineage that has demonstrated great faith. Oh, we can see it all throughout African-American history with some of the people who led the civil rights movement would demonstrate great faith. But he says, that's great, and we're surrounded by those cloud of witnesses. But now we got to fix our eyes on Jesus, because Jesus is the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith. Pioneer means he's the first, he's the lead, he's the prime example of faith. Jesus lived the life of faith, faith to his Father. And then perfecter means he brought it to completion. He closed it out. He completed the faith. Jesus was not only just a prophet, he shows us how to live by faith. How did he live by faith? Let me give you just four things that Jesus did that lived by faith. He lived in complete obedience to God, even to the point of enduring the cross. We see here later in this verse. He went all the way from birth to death, never sinning, but living in complete obedience to God. He also lived in communication with God, as we see during this Holy Week, that he would go up to the Mount of Olives and he would pray to his Father. And this, he was in constant communication with him. And it was even so that he knew what was coming, and he said, take this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. He knew that he had to obey and be in complete obedience to the Father's will. And he lived in communication. He always took time out of his day, out of his life, to go and pray to his Father. Do we do that? Do we live in constant communication with Christ, with God? Do we take time to pray to him? And not just any kind of prayer, but really have a set prayer life and allow God to talk back to us. See, we're We're not part of a relationship where we just do a one-sided communication. We're part of a relationship where God wants to talk back to us. And he does that through his word. And are we taking the time to study his word, to get into his word, to dig deep into what his word is saying so we can apply it to our lives and apply it to our prayer life? He said Jesus lived in communication with God, but not just that, he lived in obedience to God. He was obedient to death, even death on the cross. Then he also lived a life assured, confidence in the unseen future. Jesus knew that his faith would come and be completed when he died on the cross and he rose from the grave. That's what makes this passage in this day such a special one, new creation, because on Friday, he died, but he knew that on Sunday morning, he was going to rise up. He lived his life in assured confidence. And we see that as, what's the definition of faith? It says, faith is a confidence in what we hope for and the assurance of what we do not see. So new creation, can we look to what Jesus did as he was the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith? But look what it says. He says, for the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of God. He says, for the joy set before him. Sometimes the things we go through in our lives may be difficult. It may be hard, and those setbacks may be real, and we want to give up and stop running. And it shows us, he says, that Jesus endured those hardships. And he says, but for the joy set before him, he endured the cross. The cross was an ugly thing. I know we glorify it now, but it was an ugly thing. It says, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. Jesus died on the cross for us. Not only did he die, but before he even got to the cross, he was beaten beyond all recognition. He was flogged with the cat of nine tails that literally rips the flesh from your bone, from his bones. He did all this. He endured, the same word for perseverance. He endured. He saw it to completion, scorning its shame. Jesus would not let anything get in his way from dying on that cross. He would not let anything get in the way of him achieving his Father's will. And so what we see here is he was scorning his shame. And all of that happened on Friday. Friday was the shame. Friday is when he died. But the joy set before him came early Sunday morning. If I was in an old Baptist church, they would always say early Sunday morning. He got up and he rose from the grave. That is what today is all about. Jesus getting up, scorning his shame, and then going and sitting down at the right hand of the Father. Listen, that position of being on the right hand is a position of power, position of authority. And Jesus is sitting there by the hand of the Father. Jesus completed his race. Jesus completed and perfected his faith. And he shows us and he gives us the model on how to live. And now we should fix our eyes on Jesus because he's the author and finisher of our faith. But he doesn't stop there. The Hebrews writer in the last verse we're going to hear today, it says, consider him who endured such opposition from sinners so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. In other words, he says, consider Jesus. Consider all that he's done for us. Consider all that he went through. And consider the things that we have in our lives. And consider the things that are going on in our lives right now. I know you might be starting to get a little stir crazy. And COVID-19 has you scared and in fear. But Jesus, but if we consider him and we fix our eyes to Jesus, you know what we do when we fix our eyes on Jesus? We don't worry about everything else that's going on around us. When we run our race is set out for us. And then the worst thing you can do when you are running a race is you can start to look over at the people who are running with you. And as soon as you do that, you start to slow down. And when we start to look at everybody else and see, oh, well, they're not doing what they're supposed to do. And, oh, that person is going through this. Oh, this person has this problem. We slow down and we're not running our race. But what the Hebrew writer is telling us, he says, fix your eyes on Jesus. Consider him who endured the opposition of sinners, people who were trying to trip him up, trying to get him in, trying to mess him up, trying to make him stumble, trying to make him relapse or have an issue or have a problem, anything that could keep Jesus from completing his task, the devil tried to do. And we see he endured that opposition from sinners so that we can endure the opposition that we face. Listen, new creation, let's not look to the left or to look to the right or even look back in our past. Let us not look to all those things, but fix our eyes on Jesus, the one who saved our souls, the one who is the lover of our souls. It says, so that, purpose clause, so that we will not grow weary or lose heart, so that we won't give up. Listen, new creation, today is a great day because he lives. It reminds me of a hymn we used to sing growing up. It's called Because He Lives. And new creation on this Sunday, on Resurrection Sunday, because he lives. He got up from the grave. And the song and the hymn goes like this. It says, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know who holds the future. And life is worth the living just because he lives. New creation. Let us look to Jesus and fix our eyes on Jesus and know that he is alive. He rose on this Sunday morning. And because he lives, we can face tomorrow. No matter what comes our way, no matter what gets in our path, we can live for him. We can face tomorrow because he lives. Because he's already achieved it. He's already endured the cross. He's already perfected our faith. And so we can look to him. And when we look to him, all our fear is gone. When we look to him, we're not worried about what's going on beside us or behind us or what we've been through. We're looking to him and we're just facing what comes up in our path. Because he lives, our life is worth the living because he lives. Jesus, he's a way maker, new creation. He's our promise keeper and he is a miracle worker. That's who we place our faith in. That's who we live for. That's who we want to model our lives after. So no matter what comes our way, no matter what fear tries to creep into our path, let our faith be greater than our fear because he lives. God bless you and God keep you. Thank you for tuning in to our broadcast. You might be watching this video and you're not sure about your salvation. Well, let me ask you a question. If you were to die today, would you go to heaven? If the answer to that is, I don't know, or I'm not sure, or maybe not, let me just share what the Bible says. Today we saw that faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. You have to place your faith in Jesus Christ. Who is this Jesus? This Jesus was God. We believe five things about Jesus. He was God. He was the Son of God. He died on the cross for our sins. He was buried and he rose again. If you believe those five things about Jesus, we believe here at New Creation that you were saved. And we just want you to comment on any one of the videos that you have consumed, whatever platform you consumed it on. Just comment and say, I believe, and someone from our team will reach out to you. You might have enjoyed this message and want to support our ministry. Stay tuned to our announcements and you can get some information on how to give. You might be interested in coming to worship with us one day when all this quarantine stuff has happened. We're located at 9028 Ferguson Road in Dallas, Texas. We hope to have you soon. God bless you. God keep you.
Good morning, New Creation Bible Church family. This is Victoria. Happy Resurrection Sunday. I hope that you and your family are enjoying celebrating the holiday and knowing that Jesus was raised to life and is seated at the right hand of God, who is interceding for us. Let's get into our morning announcements. Join us on Zoom to connect virtually as we continue to fellowship and learn about the Word of God. Leaders, we will have a meeting on Monday, April the 13th at 7 p.m. via Zoom. See you there. Wednesdays, we will still hold Bible study at 7 p.m. via Zoom. Don't forget to download GroupMe for our very own chat room designed specifically for prayer requests and praise reports. There are still four ways to give: online, Cash App, text, or drop off at the church. We'd like to wish Melissa Jackson a very special happy birthday. Thanks so much for tuning in today. I hope that you enjoyed that message today brought to us by Pastor Paul, and that your souls will be full throughout the week. Don't forget to like, share, comment, and subscribe. And take care of yourselves, practice social distancing, and keep your hands washed at all times. Happy Easter, happy Resurrection Sunday. I hope that you enjoy your family celebrating today. And just take care of yourselves. Love you and miss you. Bye. Lord, you are everything.